Critics of the metaverse are worried about the potential impact virtual reality could have on the mental health and well-being of its users. Some psychologists have even gone as far as claim that the metaverse's impact on mental health would be nothing short of devastating, warning of an impending global psychosis outbreak. To be honest, this feels like fear-mongering to me. I say this because to this day, we don't have a single clinical study which even remotely supports this idea. The idea that the widespread adoption of metaverse technology is somehow going to lead to more people experiencing more psychotic symptoms. What we do know, however, is that several teams have already started developing virtual mental health clinics in the metaverse, and that the metaverse offers unique opportunities for the treatment of mental health conditions, opportunities which may revolutionize one of the most shorthanded fields in all of medicine. In fact, in 1995, scientists were able to treat a 19-year-old student of his severe anxiety and irrational fear of heights, acrophobia, by using virtual reality technology, a VR helmet loaded with sensors. The scientists used the VR equipment to create a glass elevator simulation, where the student could gradually work up the courage to move up all the way from the ground floor to the 49th floor of a virtual render of the Marriott Marquis Convention Hotel in Atlanta, Georgia. You can see from the table how the distress felt by the student significantly decreased following 5 sessions, each 30 minutes long, inside the simulation. Since then, there have been several outstanding studies that we will look at today, which show that simulations on the metaverse may prove useful in the treatment of mental health conditions, like anxiety and eating disorders, schizophrenia, depression, and even cognitive impairment brought on by stroke and dementia. And while the idea of a virtual metaverse may seem frighteningly unnatural to many people, the scale and adaptability of VR technology will almost definitely have valuable social uses, especially for those lacking access to basic mental health services because of the high cost of therapy. Like the 15 million Americans who suffer from social anxiety but are unable to seek help because of the costs involved. My name is Hashim and I'm a University of Cambridge graduate and student doctor, and this is my YouTube channel, Neuron Theory, where I get to answer the biggest questions about the human brain that no one really asked, except maybe for me. If that's your thing, then make sure you subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified when I post my next video. And now, back to the metaverse. The metaverse is a network of 3D worlds and simulations that you are able to experience with your sense of sight, hearing, and even more recently, your sense of touch. This enables users to interact with each other and their environment in a seemingly realistic way, which creates a deeply immersive experience. So immersive that despite knowing full well that these simulations are not real, your brain still responds to these images and these sounds as if they were very real, which allows scientists and clinicians to recreate situations that a patient may find stressful or traumatic as a virtual simulation. The patient is then inserted into the simulation, and the intensity of the simulation is gradually increased until the patient can overcome their distress or trauma. In 2019, 12 former veterans diagnosed with PTSD received 6 sessions in a war zone VR simulation. The result? A significant decrease in their PTSD symptoms. The change was also a lasting one, with the former veterans' improvement in well-being remaining largely unchanged at follow-up 6 months later. Perhaps even more wild is this other study, where severely depressed patients were made to comfort an avatar, a computer avatar of a crying child in a virtual simulation, soothing the child with words of compassion. The depressed patients then switched bodies with the child and received the same compassionate response from an adult computer avatar. And 3 things happened. The depressed patients were more compassionate towards themselves, they were far less critical, and their depression scores fell significantly and continued to fall 4 weeks after the end of the experiment. This only scratches the surface of what's possible in the metaverse, because in the metaverse you can be anyone and do anything. Think of the impact this may have on a high school bully, who gets to spend a week in a virtual simulation where they're the underdog and they're the ones being bullied. Or a patient struggling with anorexia, using an avatar in the metaverse to address their distorted body image. At least, that's what researchers found in 2016 when they created a full-body avatar for a group of patients with anorexia. The research team reinforced the illusion by using a brush to stroke the patient's stomach, while the patient was looking through their Oculus Rift DK2 goggles at their virtual bodies and seeing the same stroking motion, but on the avatar. This is known as synchronization, because it combines the two senses, in this case touch and vision, to achieve a more realistic VR experience. At the end of the study, the patients were significantly less likely to overestimate key body metrics like their shoulder and hip width and stomach and hip circumference. In other words, these anorexic patients who had a deeply distorted view of their real bodies were less likely to think of themselves as being fat after experiencing the virtual body of a computer-generated avatar. And these effects were found to last for almost a year post-treatment. If you'd like to read the full research papers yourself, head over to the description below where you'll find a link to my free newsletter on Substack. Use that link and you'll find a list of all the references that I used in this video. One way we can make VR therapy even more powerful is by combining it with NIBS, or non-invasive brain stimulation. NIBS is a technique that is currently being used by scientists and clinicians around the world to non-invasively send electrical and magnetic impulses to key areas of the brain, causing them to fire. The idea is that when you combine this with therapy, you can change the strength of individual synapses in key areas of the brain, or how certain neurons are able to communicate with other neurons. This technique has actually been used in combination with VR therapy in the treatment of schizophrenia, where specific brain regions responsible for emotional, social, and behavioral cognition were targeted with these magnetic impulses before a VR therapy session. Needless to say, the results were very encouraging. Combining VR therapy with NIBS was able to accelerate the brain's natural neuroplastic changes, giving stronger and faster results. One thing to note is that most patients treated with VR therapy seem to really like it. They find it a lot more enjoyable and a far less clinical experience than other forms of therapy. The simulations can also be easily adjusted with a few lines of code based on each patient's individual needs. Add this to the fact that in the future, anyone with a smartphone will be able to access these mental health services or programs at their own convenience, whether it be from their home, work, or even while they're on the move. They can also remain anonymous if they so choose, addressing issues surrounding stigma, privacy, and mental health. The cost of VR equipment is also expected to decrease in the coming years. An Oculus headset will set you back roughly $300 today, but as little as a decade ago, you could have expected to pay upwards of a couple of thousand dollars for a far less capable piece of technology, which will only improve with time, especially with the recent interest and investment in VR and metaverse technologies. Just imagine a world where a Karen can put on her VR headset and use her smartphone to enter a metaverse where she can scream and shout and release all her pent-up anger at other Karens, getting instant relief in the process, instead of traumatizing an innocent kid who's only trying to sell some lemonade. Now tell me in the comments what the first thing that you plan to do in the metaverse is, assuming of course that you can do anything and be anyone you like. You'll find my answer down there too. If you enjoyed this video, then you should subscribe to the channel for more weekly videos about the human brain and a bunch of unnecessary Taylor Swift references. You have been warned all too well. Don't forget to give this video a thumbs up and see you all next week.